Hi, I'm Wayne Tuttle, and this is Chasing Legends. Hi, I'm Wayne Tuttle. This is Chasing Legends. I'm here again with Salvador DelGadillo. We're in Tucson when we film this at the Arizona Film Festival for Lust for Gold, Race Against Time. Keep pushing that narrative and be in theaters at this point. Go down, check it out, pick up the DVD, Blu-ray. You won't be sorry, will they?
No.
Salvador hasn't
we'll
seen it.
We'll enjoy it. You will enjoy it.
Salvador hasn't seen it. It's his first chance.
Yeah.
First chance tonight. So
premiere tonight.
By the time you see this, he'll have seen it and he'll probably like it. We're hoping. So, okay, today here we're going to talk about another subject matter near and dear to Sal's heart. But first, hit subscribe, hit notifications bell, go to about and get one of the shirts, Dutch Hunter Rendezvous shirts, Legend of the Superstition Mountain shirt, short sleeve, long sleeve, gray, black. Sal wants one, don't you? He says he paid me for one, so I got to get him, and he wants a Rendezvous shirt. Rendezvous shirt. Okay, today our subject matter is going to be what year, when, and how did you meet Bob Ward?
I come here in March 17, 1982, and I spent a couple months in the mountains. And I met Bob Ward in the summer of 1982, in the corner of Apache Trail and Mining Camp Road.
No, but you met Bob Ward, so you met him on the side of the road, or how did you guys run into each other?
I was staying in a camp in the corner of Apache Trail, like a block away from Goldfield. And he showed up with Bambi, Superstition Bambi. And when I looked at her, I thought Bambi was his daughter, and I come to find out that Bambi was his wife. I said, oh hell, you know. Thank God he never...
We're streaming on YouTube, you can say shit.
I said, oh hell, man. She was beautiful. She was half Italian. I found out later she was half Italian and half Apache.
Yeah.
Beautiful woman. And that's how I met Bob Ward.
So what was your first meeting with him like? Did it go off well, or did he kind of give
up? Well, I was more interested in looking at Bambi, I thought Bambi was his daughter, because she was younger than he was.
You were thinking about making a play?
Yeah, I make a move, but
no?
I found out later that it was his wife, and I say wrong move.
Yeah, especially with Bob Ward.
Didn't
he shoot somebody for that kind of stuff before?
Yeah, he used to carry a long .45, you know, revolver. Big bullets.
But didn't he shoot someone? Was with one of his wives?
Well, that's a long story. We don't want to get into it.
Okay, we don't want to get into it, but supposedly he shot someone, was with his wife.
Yeah, and...
That was that guy's fault.
Well, I don't know.
Could have been you, Sal.
Yeah, it could have been me.
Uh-oh. Okay, so you meet Bob Ward then. When do you guys become friends?
One of those things where people either like you or don't like you. And Bob Ward was the kind of person that either he like you or he don't like you. With no 50-50 with him, it's one way or the other.
Yeah. Oh, okay, so you met Bob. Now tell me the story. Bob thought you were talking too much. He thought you were talking to people too much. He brought you in. Did he call you and tell you to come over and come in the cabin?
I was in the cabin, and all of a sudden he said, Salvador, you talk too much, and I asked him why. He said, because you have no right to tell people the things. And I said, Bob, I've been here for a few years, And I know a lot, and I believe that knowledge will be shared.
Okay.
So in case something happened to us, knowledge can go on and on and on. If we cannot put the pieces together, we have no right to deny the next generation the right to piece it together.
Okay. And he didn't take kindly to that still.
Yeah, he also treated me with respect, and he was talked to me nice to me, and that day he talked to me like an officer, army officer. He said, sit down and don't move. And I sat down and don't move. When all of a sudden his eyes got biggest saucers. And he asked me, who is next to you? And I say, Bob, it's only two people in the cabin here, you and I. I don't know what you're talking about this, but he told me that he saw somebody next to me protecting me.
So he was gonna shoot you?
I believe that he don't meant for the ghost that he described later. I would have been dead a long time ago.
So he was going to just take you out then and put you down a pit or a mine?
A mine shaft.
Yeah, stick you in a mine shaft?
Yeah, but nobody would know the difference.
So Sal, there's always the legends and the stories about stuff like that, and we joke. So are there bodies down in those shafts?
I believe they are.
You believe there are?
I believe they are.
Yeah? Do you think that people there should be some sort of closure for that for people? Do you think sometimes the curse of bad luck that people associated from back then, the reason their lives sometimes they run into bad luck is because those things are hanging over them out there still?
I would believe that when I, now looking back after 40 years, 2020, that the mountain is like an amplifier.
Yeah.
You come here with a positive attitude, make it bigger. It's a positive attitude. And you come here with a negative attitude and made out the whole world and paranoid, it make it more paranoid.
Now, Bob Ward was a very smart man. He was very articulate.
He was articulate.
He was very skilled at art.
And very intelligent, very intelligent, very intelligent.
Very high IQ. But do you think it amplified negativity from him? Or maybe problems inside of him? Because for me, you read certain people, you thought Bob Ward was a great guy.
I never say he was not a bad guy.
But there was a dark side to him.
And you had to accept it.
Yeah.
You had to accept it. You're going to be a treasure hunt, and it's a risk you had to take.
Yeah.
I mean, you can get killed any time, but you was fair.
Well, I won't kill you, Sal.
No, you're saying that it come along with the territory.
Comes with back then, especially.
Back in those days,
happened quite a bit back then in those days with him and Chuck Crawford and a lot of people involved in the back of the mountains. Now, I'm not going to ask names because we don't want to name names because people don't like that. That's kind of that.
Well, we have to respect the family, you know.
Yeah, the families and the people that are still living. There are people still walking and talking and moving around.
I'm not scared to die. I had to show respect.
Okay, and we show respect to those people. So we don't name names all the time of certain people that share stories unless they give us permission.
Yeah, they give me permission, then I don't got no problem with that.
Now, another story I want to ask about you, kind of out there with Bob Ward, and this was situated around the Kovacs chicken mine. You know where that's at?
My God, that was the best chicken you can...
Yeah, I know the chicken was good and the signs in the mine, but what about the mine shaft? Did you ever go down in that mine?
I thought you were talking about the...
I'm not talking about the chicken place. I'm talking about the mine.
Oh, the Kovacs mine.
It has the chicken sign in it. We call it the Kovacs chicken sign because it has the Kovacs chicken sign in it.
They talk about the store and Apache Trail. That was the little chicken.
I know. Everybody's talking
Well,
that.
You know, this is the whole thing, okay?
Yeah.
When I met Bob Ward, he was living in a white suburban.
Year was this? About 82, 83?
1982.
Okay.
In the summer of 82. And every time that... Bambi see me, she give me a bottle of water or a Pepsi, whatever she got, because she liked me a lot, and I like it a lot. And one day, I met the cook once, the Los Angeles Mine
Henry
store.
The cook, right?
Henry the cook,
He was in the cabin up there.
And I met him once at the Los Angeles Mine store. Ernie was there talking to Ernie.
Ernie Province.
Yes. And one day, Ernie partner got a partner whose name was Don Hensley.
Don Hensley, yes.
And Don Hensley was a worker a friend and a worker at the same time for any province. And then next thing I know, the cook supposed to commit suicide. His partner went out with the money claims.
Hensley.
And it's a duty story that's hard to get into.
Now, when the cook shot himself, he supposedly shot himself in the cabin.
I doubt it.
He supposedly shot himself in the cabin, but somehow he made it out, made a left turn, and walked down the road, right?
He's supposed to make it to the door, and he never make it.
Yeah. So, and the blood was in there, did you see afterwards? When Bob was moved in, because Bob Ward moved in after that,
and
right?
And that's what I'm saying, it's a long, dirty story.
Yeah.
When I went there, Bob asked me to go there. It was 2 weeks later. Blood was in the floor, holding the ceiling, and with blood was dripping all the way to the door, and it stinged like hell heaven, you know, high heaven. And people don't want to believe it, but 2 weeks later, that's my story, okay?
Yeah.
Because I went through it. I believe that Don Hensley, not Don Hensley, but Henry the Cook energy was there. Because you can feel it there.
You can feel his energy still there.
Energy there. Mm-hmm. And I say, you know, Henry, I don't know what happened. I don't shoot you. The people tell me that you shoot you, but I doubt it. But I can tell you one thing. I come here in peace and I don't want no trouble.
Yeah.
And about 3 days later, he kind of leave me alone because I think he realized that I had nothing to do with it.
Now, Lee Compton died not too long after that, too.
Lee Compton got killed in Apache Junction, and I saw the body.
That was by the Lost Dutchman store, you said, right?
No, he died in Apache Junction.
Oh, okay, where at?
By Idaho.
Yeah.
A store in Idaho, and I saw them bringing them out, dragging their feet, putting in the middle of the pickup truck, and next thing the body appears in Peralta Road, in the first.
So you saw them drag and put him in the pickup truck? So he was in Apache Junction at Idaho Road.
Someone
load him into the truck.
Two people there.
And then they took him to Peralta Road and dumped him off.
They're talking in the middle by the shoulders. We each of them put the arms around their neck to make it look like he was drunk.
Those people still alive?
I think they're dead by now.
Okay, so we're not going to say names regardless?
No, because...
Families?
If they was alive, I'm supposed to talk about it because I want the truth to be told, but since they're dead, there's no sense to dragging the family into...
Do you know why they killed him?
Yeah, they killed him in the store and they drag him out.
But why did they kill him?
Part of the problem is, this is a long story, he had a partner in Scottsdale.
Yeah.
And after he got killed, he was to be like a caretaker for the Coral Circle U.
Yeah.
And after he got killed, his friend from Scottsdale was the next successor in Coral Circle U. And it's kind of a funny story. Why one person get killed and the partner take over.
Yeah.
So there's no way I can explain it. Even to this day, I can explain it.
Now, I'll add the south, and right around the same exact time at the San Mateo Castro Ranch,
Trapper got shot.
Now, do you know anything about that?
Well, this dog.
And his dog, Blue. Blue was shot and buried under the tree right there by the
cabin. Okay. Back to the same story, right where Lee Compton got shot,
yeah.
I was able to see a piece of it's called Apache tear, like this.
Apache tear, okay. Which is obsidian, basically.
Obsidian glass.
Yes.
Because it's not a rock, it's glass.
Yeah.
With nuggets, gold nuggets. And I was able to see that, and about 2 weeks later, Trapper got killed. What a coincidence that I see something like that, and 2 weeks later, the guy gets shot.
You know, now, the barber, did you know Bimo, the barber?
Oh, he was my favorite barber in Apache Junction.
Yeah, Bimo's barber, it's still Barber Plaza, but it doesn't say, but it was Bimo's Barber Plaza.
Yeah, he was
now, why did he, why did he shoot Trapper? Because he admitted it, he went to prison for it.
I believe that was a group that killed him.
It was a group?
And he used to take medicines to control his, whatever he was.
Yeah.
And somebody would hold the medicine so they can blame it on him.
So he was kind of set up, you think, a little?
He was set up by his friends, by the same people who killed Lee Compton. So it was like a one, two.
So you're saying they got him riled up and made sure he didn't have his medicine to get him fired up to send him out that way. So he did it, but they made sure he was kind of out of control and get him out.
Sound like they poke him in the ribs to react to something.
Okay, yeah.
But the funny thing is, the same people that killed Lee Compton, they're the same people who kill Trapper.
And all that stuff, Henry DeCook, Lee Compton, Trapper, all that happens around the same time.
Well, I would say pretty close.
Yeah, pretty close.
Pretty close.
That area, it's like a triangle of all kinds of strange things happening.
The Devil's Triangle.
Yeah, it could be.
Yeah,
could
the
be
Devil's
because
Triangle.
A lot of stuff happened. So, and you didn't take part in any of that stuff.
Well, I personally.
Why are you hesitating? You're supposed to say no.
Well, I personally believe because Bill Bimo was my best friend.
Yeah.
And he was very nice to me that he got set up. And the reason I say that because I saw the body drag out of the same store where I saw the glass, obsidian glass, and the same people who was involved and they went up there. So, and it's a long story that when I have time I explain it to you, you give me time.
Yeah, someday we'll talk about it. But it was now, was this circle of people just poking a little?
Same circle, killed two people.
Little circle. But Bob Ward, was it those people in Bob Ward's circle? The people that did these things?
No, there was a different circle.
Was it Chuck Crawford's?
No, it was not Chuck Crawford's.
So it was outside of those groups. And those groups were dangerous enough.
Yeah, but...
Because they shot people and did stuff too.
Yeah, but these people, When there was like outsiders, it was not inside. It was
so they weren't the mountain men. That
no,
kind
no,
of
no,
group.
No, they weren't the men. It was people who come from back east.
And we still do, obviously. We do the rendezvous, which kind of followed, and it wasn't didn't happen because, but there was the mountain man rendezvous that Bob Warden we have. With all, and you were out there.
Every 10 years.
Every 10 years. Every and you made a made a couple of those. And you
I made one.
Made it one.
I made the second one. I made
and that was a who's who of kind of unsavory characters. Well, and we'll say, an unsafe group of unsavory characters and Tom Columborn, because Tom's right in the middle of all that with his white hat.
Yeah, well, Tom Columborn was a historian, so he had the right to be there, right or wrong. Yeah. Or he's trying to tell the story, which he had the right to be there no matter what.
Well, he was friends with everybody.
Well, he never make enemies.
No, Tom was always, and he was always good to everybody.
Yeah, that's why he never make enemies.
So, and he'd been back in there for so long. He knew as much or more than any of us.
I believe he knew more than Bob Ward because he was there in the 50s.
Yeah, he was a cowboy 40s, 50s, back in the day and stuff. And so you came in long after, say, Henry Burns and his wife.
That's
dead,
another thing. Henry Burns was there before I show up. But you're talking about Henry Burns, Lincoln, Trapper, three people in the same Devil's Triangle.
And let's cover one more person before we say goodbye to everybody today. Did you ever meet Crazy Jake?
Not in person.
Not in person. So somehow you avoided him. Because Ron Feldman and Bob Shoes, Brian Lichtman, they all worked for him. So all these guys that you're around, and it worked, did that warn you from him? Did you kind of stay away because you kind of heard from them that, it's...
I can tell you a story.
Okay, tell me a story.
About Crazy Jake. I met Crazy Jake through other people's stories, but I never met him personally. One time I was landscaping, and I went back to town from a Superstition and Mountain View, to the corner, and I started walking in Superstition and Apache Trail. I saw a Mexican coming down Apache Trail, right at Superstition, where today they got the roundabout. And I wait for him and I say, hey, what you doing here? He told me that story that I want to tell because Tom Columborn wrote about it, and when I asked him about it, he said he don't remember running it. I said, Tom Columborn, how you can say you never did it when I read your article? It made me look like crazy. He told me that in Tijuana, Mexico, he met one of the Peralta families, and that woman have a map and like a deer skin.
Yeah.
Deer skin. And he won the map, and she let him have a copy. And the funny thing about it, that he and I was looking almost for the same thing.
Yeah.
And it's called the dagger, the Spanish dagger that is in the store maps. And that's what I've been trying to tell people for years and years. And the story can't come from told, like in the 40s, the Mexican family come from Mexico, and the story that come from Mexico starts on Florence.
Yeah.
And in Florence, they went from Florence, they hired Americans, and they went from Florence to Escuela Cinco U. And from Escuela Cinco U, they went up on what they call Tortilla Flat Trail on top of the mountain.
Yeah.
And the way back, they come back with gold. And by the time they get to Florence, one of the Americans killed a Mexican. And when they went to court, the American says it was self-defense.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's in the story.
Yeah.
Now this guy show up like 40 years later, and he claims that the same woman who was hit in the 40s is the woman he met in Tijuana, Mexico, Baja California, Mexico. And he told, when you go to the mountain, look for the dagger.
Yeah.
And ask him, do you find the dagger? She said, no. And I tried to tell him where he was at, and the next day I had to pull gravel for the driveway. And I told him to wait for me one more day and I'll go with you. He said he can hardly wait. So I had a friend of mine to take him to Crosswater to supplies. And I never saw him again. Next thing I know, he got pushing bighorns.
Yeah.
And descending to Mexico, his name was Salvador Cervera. And lots of people confused him with me. And even Talamborn confuse him with me because he met Salvador before I come to Apache Junction.
Yeah.
And the funny thing is that how it's possible that I can't remember the story about 1940, In the 80s, this guy met the same woman in Mexico. She mentioned the dagger. I mentioned the dagger. So everything points together. And he told me, in order for you to know where the dry place, you had to find the dagger. And I knew where the dagger was. He got sent to Mexico. I never saw him again.
Well, thank you, everybody, and thank you, Salvador, once again. You're very patient.
Yeah.
You have a flower in your hair.
Yeah, it's a golden nugget.
Have you ever been to San Francisco? That's a song, remember?
Yeah, I went to San Francisco.
There's a song that goes like that. Anyways, myself, Salvador DelGadillo, thank you very, very much. Say goodbye to Sal. Sal, tell everybody thanks for watching Chasing Legends in Spanish.
Me gustaría que vieran las leyendas de la... Las leyendas de las supersticiones.
So thank you for watching Chasing Legends, everybody. Please take care. Me and Sal will be around. See us in the mountains. Say hi, all right? Thank you, everybody. Take care. We'll catch you next time. Chasing Legends.